Hello, everybody. My name is Yves Larose. I'm the CEO and founder of the EOS Network Foundation. I've been in the blockchain space now for a little over a decade. I've seen many trends come and go, and I've seen the vision of what blockchain was to be and my understanding of what blockchain could come and help fulfill change over the years as well. But I'm here today to talk to you about one of the things that I've seen that has ramped up over the last couple of years, but more so in the last couple of months, and that is real-world assets, RWAs. They're not a new concept, but in their current iteration and what I'm seeing and what I'll talk about today and why it's different, why now, I hope that you're going to get a better understanding of where this industry is going and where I believe blockchain will be able to play a significant role for real-world assets. To start it off, to give a little bit of context, I'm not going to go over what real-world assets are. I will assume that you're already knowledgeable of what they are. Obviously, if you're listening to me talk right now, it's because you have an interest in them. And so we'll kick off with that. And really, what I'll focus on today is why now, what I'm seeing, what are current trends, what is different, and how you can potentially position yourself to be able to benefit from what I believe is about to come within this space. And so real-world assets, I think, are quite significant because they have a huge potential market. We look at different studies, and there's one in particular done from the Boston Consultation Group, BCG, that predicted and that showcased that before 2030 or by 2030, real-world assets and assets in general, the tokenization of assets in general, is going to be a multi-trillion dollar market. The highest projections are up to $68 trillion worth, but the lower conservative are around the $18 to $20 trillion mark. And we're nowhere near that today. And so obviously in terms of opportunity in what blockchain can provide within that space, there's a lot of room to grow. And in this current time, I think what's important, what's interesting is that we're seeing a shift. And that's really what I want to focus on today. Historically, real world assets from the industry perspective were being developed and were being brought by teams leveraging the technology and leveraging where the technology was within the limitations of current regulations and where regulations are to bring about, let's say, proof of concepts. What we're seeing that's different in the last couple of months is that jurisdictions around the world have been needing to make regulatory changes in order to be able to benefit and or launch their own real world assets for their own needs. This is quite significant. As I said, I've been in this space now for quite some time, and it's the first time that I see governments around the world needing to make changes to their respective regulations in order to be able to leverage blockchain technology. And why that's significant, why that's different, is because when industry is looking at making changes, it's quite difficult. If industry goes to government and asks for regulatory changes, the typical turnaround time is quite long before regulatory changes are made. There's a lot of education that needs to occur. There's a lot of lobbying that needs to occur. And then in order for that to happen, obviously there's a lot of time that needs to pass for governments to be able to understand why those changes are perhaps beneficial, while also at the same time ensuring that their citizens, from their point of view, are being kept safe, quote unquote. What we're seeing that's different in the last couple of months is we've seen a reversal of this, whereby now governments are wanting to unlock real-world asset benefits leveraging blockchain, and they're blocked. They're blocked because their regulations don't allow for those use cases to come to fruition without regulatory changes. And obviously, if government has a particular need for regulation changes, then the time which it takes to be able to make those changes can be fast-tracked because they have their own need and they're essentially in control of the machine. And this is what we're seeing is different. And I'll give a few concrete examples. So why now? For example, in Hong Kong right now, an area where I do a lot of work, historically, Northern territories are put up for sale to developers within the country in order to expand land. Hong Kong has a very tight control over the supply of land within the islands. And so this process has historically been very limited to who could participate. There are only a few developers that historically can participate in these auctions, essentially, of land. And the way that I understand it right now, the way that the regulations are currently written work for this system because the number of potential participants bidding for land is quite limited. And if this magic number is exceeded, the way that the regulations are written, that sale potentially becomes a collective investment scheme. And so we now find ourselves, or the Hong Kong government finds itself in a position where it wants to open the sale of lands in the Northern Territories to further global partners, not limited to the in-house Hong Kong developers. In order to be able to do that, they want to pilot it through tokenization of assets. Obviously, the fractionalization of those pieces of land, it enables more investors to be able to participate, having a global investment pool possible, also having a smaller barrier to entry in terms of cost as well, because maybe you don't need to buy the whole plot, but you can just buy a portion of. So all of the benefits that we've been discussing about the real world assets, the Hong Kong government is looking at benefiting from that or leveraging that. But they can't do this because of that magical collective investment scheme number, whereby if they go over that number of potential investors, it becomes a collective investment scheme. So going back to what I said, the government is now having to look at its own regulations, pushing regulatory changes in order for it to be able to benefit from the use case that it wants. And that's relevant because once that regulatory change is made, it opens up the same function then to industry. And this is quite new. Whereby, like I said before, industry has been pushing for changes, and regulatory changes from that point of view is extremely difficult to overcome, and it's quite lengthy. When government pushes for regulatory changes, it can be much shorter, much more efficient, but still get the benefits afterwards to industry. Another concrete example of this is what we're seeing in Thailand right now. There's been a new government change, and there's been political change in Thailand over the last couple of months. And one of the platforms and one of the big files that the government has been pushing for is essentially to be able to airdrop, in a way, tokens to citizens and the difficulties of being able to do that. On their side, it's less of a regulatory challenge because they can push this through relatively easy. For them, it's more of a technical challenge. And so this trifecta of challenges that we need to overcome for RWAs are three-part. One is the technical side, the legal side, the other one is the market. So Hong Kong is more of an example of the regulations, and Thailand in this case is a more technical challenge where in order to be able to airdrop tokens, they're having to create pilot projects and work with layer ones or layer twos to figure out how they'll technically be able to do this. Because once they figure out that part, they've got the government support or they've got the legislative support. And so their challenges are very different. And this is only the beginning. We're starting to see governments around the world in very real ways wanting to try and catch up from a blockchain point of view integration, in part because they have to, because they need to find more new creative ways of generating revenue and or lowering costs. And the benefits of blockchain enable this. This is another one of the trends that we're seeing, is that the product itself, the use case itself is what's at the forefront. And that's only possible because of the benefits of what blockchain come about. And this is a very new change. So obviously within the industry, we've been talking about this for a while. We've been talking about the benefits of blockchain, the benefits of what the technology can bring, lowering the costs, less middlemen, more efficiencies, et cetera, et cetera. But we've not seen governments around the world being able to see that they have that need as well. And that's the shift that we're seeing. And that third part of what I was talking about is the market. We're also seeing more and more market participants looking at tokenization of assets as a means to be able to either generate more profit or reduce costs, in large part because of inflation. Obviously, that gets translated back to industry. And if they can cut their costs or heighten their revenues, which is obviously their goal, then they can profit more. And we're starting to see them look at blockchain for that particular purpose as well. So it's less about the blockchain as the feature, more about the need of the blockchain in order to achieve what they're looking to achieve. And that's the significant shift that we're having. And that's where real world assets are going to play a key role within this. So going back to that Boston Consultation Group study that was made a few years back, we're seeing that this idea of tokenization of assets is one that focuses on the product itself, and that's got a massive market cap opportunity, whereby this is one of the ways I strongly believe we're going to see mass adoption of blockchain as a tool, as an extra technology in your back pocket, not because the technology itself was what was at the forefront and what was sold, but the product itself is what's now being adapted, leveraging the technology behind as a bonus, as an extra means to be able to achieve the ultimate goal. So what can we do as an industry to prepare for this inevitable flow of demand that is going to come on the market? So first of all, you need to believe that the premise is that there's going to be a need for this piece of technology. And if you're listening to me right now, and or if you're working in this space, I would imagine that you believe that this technology, blockchain, at some point will be integrated into our daily lives. Whether or not it's at the forefront of what you're interacting with because you're aware of it or not is somewhat irrelevant. If you believe that this piece of technology is going to reach mass adoption, at some point we're going to need to meet that demand with supply. And if you're listening to me right now, perhaps you're part of stakeholders that is working on increasing that supply essentially. So if you're a developer, what can you do? Well, everything I've said right now will need rails. It will need key pieces of integration that might not exist right now. So if we're focusing on the product, for example, let's go back to the Thailand example. In order to be able to airdrop to citizens, well, you're going to need a blockchain that's going to be able to meet that demand from an account creation point of view. That blockchain will need to have minimal transaction fees as well as then hardware costs in order to be able to meet that demand. You're going to need to scale, because if the idea is that this is only the beginning and Thailand starts integrating more governmental services onto the blockchain, then you're going to need more and more data points to be written. This blockchain will need to be secure. It'll need to be reliable. You're going to need to have components in there that are currently not built to facilitate, on the government side, for example, integration within the blockchain. So that likely means more SDKs, that means more libraries, that means more of these infrastructure pieces that are key to be able to connect to current Web 2. And this is what I'm seeing as well in terms of trend, in terms of investment. We're seeing the ebb and flow over time of where dollars are being spent from investors external to Web 3 into Web 3. And that will be ebb and flow depending on the flavor of the year or what's currently hot right now. So if we talk about GameFi, for example, or we talk about DeFi or NFTs, those are things that have come and gone in a way, but the components that have been built remain. The one thing that hasn't changed throughout this investment thesis that I'm seeing over the last couple of years is that infrastructure play. It's those base components, those base layers that are needed no matter what the use case is. And so if you're a developer right now, or if you're a stakeholder that's got a business and focusing on the integration of blockchain, I think you've got a very bright future ahead, because inevitably, if the premise is that there's going to be tremendous demand, we will need to be there with supply. So think about what you could do that might work cross-chain so that you're not pegged to one particular chain. Something that you could do that you could provide whereby that functionality is somewhat of a plugin that can be embedded in any use case because the function itself is required for multiple use cases. If you're a business, look at what you could provide in terms of a specific use case and how you can embed yourself within a particular area of RWAs, for example. Think about what would be a great first step, what could be a proof of concept that would actually lower the cost or heighten revenue or make things easier for the end user focusing on the product. So again, this idea of focusing on the product instead of focusing on the blockchain. So you perhaps currently have a particular business and you can integrate blockchain into it. How could you do that so that it is seamless, so that your end user doesn't even know? So that it's an additional benefit to them, but that's not what attracts them in the first place. That's one of the things you could do. And if you're on the investor side of things, what could you potentially do in order to be able to increase this space again, because you might see a return in the next 7-8 years if those projections pan out, in terms of positioning yourself to be able to get a return on those investments as this market inevitably grows? So those are, I think, the couple of areas whereby external stakeholders could participate in. If you're on the government side of things or on the legislative side of things and you're listening to this right now, what could you do within your own regulatory body that perhaps would require or would benefit from having blockchain integration so that you can help the industry moving forward by having a particular use case on your end that requires regulatory changes that you're able to help push through so that industry can benefit afterwards? Those are a few of the places I believe that people can concretely help right now. If you're listening to me right now as well, and you have ideas, or you've got a pitch deck, or you've got any contacts that is working in this space, and they're looking for more information, they're looking at how they can contribute, share, talk, join these calls. I'm seeing over the last 6 months, more and more talks about RWAs. I'm being asked to talk about RWAs more and more frequently over the last 6 months. One thing that I believe is undeniable is that RWAs are a perfect example of a use case that can benefit from tokenization from blockchain technology. Whether it's in the next year, whether it's in the next 5 years and the next 10 years, having a stake in the game, I think, is something that is quite significant in terms of an opportunity that it represents. So with all this and with all these opportunities, what am I doing to prepare for this? Well, for one, as the founder and CEO of the EOS Network Foundation, we're making sure that our code stack is ready to be able to accommodate this, what I believe is the inevitable demand coming on us by producing more supply. So we're working on things like infinite parallelization, essentially infinite scalability in multiple different ways. We're working with teams that are working on RWAs, for example, in the carbon offset credit space, rewards programs, being able to offer the underlying technology, but also the legal support, the marketing support, and all kinds of other supports to be able to help industry and governments be able to leverage this piece of technology. In large part, we're doing this in part of the world where I believe are pushing these boundaries forward quite rapidly. So if this was interesting to you and you want to learn more about RWAs, or you want to learn more about what you can do specifically to help contribute to this growing trend, as well as maybe capture this opportunity that is presenting itself, feel free to reach out to me. You can reach out to me on Twitter. My handle is @BigBeardSamurai. On Telegram, same thing, @BigBeardSamurai. Or please feel free to go look at the eosnetwork.com website, where you can find tremendous amount of resources as well as documentation on what the network as a whole is working on, what our engineers are working on, and what we are doing in this space inside and outside of RWAs to be able to prepare for what we believe is the inevitable demand on blockchain as a whole. And with that, thank you very much for listening to me today, and I hope that you all have a great UDC. Take care.